Toronto's Sky Dome, the first multi-use stadium in the world to boast a retractable roof, an all-weather year-round sports and entertainment palace hosting up to 70,000 people at a time. A city in a building.
Jerry Agar and Toronto's breaking news, traffic and weather. News Talk 1010.
Okay!
The Sky Dome opened to great celebration and a national broadcast from the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation, and it rained. It didn't go so well, apparently. Do you remember this? We're thinking about it today as the home opener takes place tonight, and half of us are walking around here in the building today in Blue Jays shirts and hats, etc. But Ed Conroy, Conroy writes for blog TO, the soggy history behind the opening of the Sky Dome. So a little trip down Toronto memory lane here. Ed, good morning.
Good morning, Jerry.
Good to have you. So it was going to be a big whoop-de-doo, wasn't it?
The biggest.
Yeah. Well, you also write that maybe the CBC contributed to this by thinking they were going to have kind of the broadcast of the century or something.
Yeah, I mean, you got to remember, it was the end of the 80s, and that decade was, you know, known for excess. And it kind of was a fitting end to that decade to go out like that. And, you know, you look at that footage now, and it's like it's from another planet, really.
Well, let's go back a little bit. How did we end up with a dome? You're saying it's because Premier Bill Davis didn't like getting wet at sporting events.
Well, I mean, really, I think a lot of people go back to the Grey Cup of 82 when you had the telecast. It was Argos lost to the Eskimos. And you had these Argos fans just completely drenched. And Bill Davis, obviously a premier known for, you know, being a man of action, he used that to his political gain and said it's time for Toronto to have a world-class sports arena. So that's kind of where it came from. So it was fitting, I think, that on the gala opening of Sky Dome, they got drenched.
Quite a number of people who live in Toronto, because so many people move here. I moved here after the place was built and may find it hard to believe that there was actually space for it down there. It was a pretty empty area.
Oh, my goodness. It was like a gigantic empty parking lot.
Yeah, well, it's being filled up with condos now pretty effectively. But I guess the problem came down to they had all this entertainment on opening day. Was opening day, Ed, and I couldn't determine this for sure from your column, and I was trying to look it up, was opening day just to open up and show off the Sky Dome, or was there also some sort of sporting event that night?
No. You see, what happened, unfortunately, they had tried to time it so that the opening night game of the Jays was going to be the opening of the Sky Dome. But there was all kinds of headaches along the way, and things ran late. So they were actually a couple of months after the Jays' home opener. And so to kind of make up for that, they devised this sort of gigantic gala celebration that would be broadcast across the nation on CBC with all these bands and sort of entertainers. And there was no sporting event, but it was meant to make up for the fact that there was no sport.
Okay, but there was Alan Thicke and Andrea Martin and Glass Tiger, I think, was there.
And André Philippe Gagnon. I mean, it was, you know, I think I describe it in the piece as it's like something out of The Simpsons. Like, it's just, it's bananas, you know, and you keep thinking they're going to acknowledge that it's this ridiculous thing, but they don't. It just keeps getting more and more ridiculous. And this all culminates, of course, in the dome opening up, and they're all singing this song, Open Up the Dome, and the people are yelling, Close the Dome, because they're getting absolutely drenched.
Well, you also point out, and I don't know how many people remember this, I was unaware of this, the Sky Dome had its own mascot named Domer.
Oh, of course, Domer the Turtle. And he was actually designed by the guys who started Nelvana, which is, you know, Canada's sort of foremost animation company. And, you know, there was Domer plush dolls, and there was a guy in a Domer costume. And unfortunately, he never really caught on to the public conscience, like, say, BJ Birdie did.
Yeah.
But I think people that were there, they treasure their Domer stuffed animals.
By the way, my producer George has just dug this up. The first game in the Dome was June 5th, 1989, against the Milwaukee Brewers, who play tonight in the season opener.
Well, there's more symmetry, and it looks like it's going to rain again. So we're perfect.
Yeah, but now people are happy if they keep the dome closed. The thing is, they knew that they had lightning and rain, but they were so dedicated to opening that thing and showing it off that they opened it anyway and drenched everybody.
Absolutely, and that's one of the things I wish, you know, imagine being a fly on the wall when they were arguing about whether to open it or not, because they were, had all this pressure. They'd spent, you know, over $500 million on this thing, and the whole country was watching, and they couldn't not open it. But, you know, by opening it, they got everybody wet, and then there was all kinds of trouble because they had people in rare ceremonial dresses, and the dresses got destroyed, and you had people slipping and breaking, not breaking their legs, but injuring themselves. So it was kind of a big fiasco, and I think it's been sort of brushed under the carpet. And so I was so happy when I discovered the videotape and was able to put that online.
You know, Ed, as you were talking about being a fly on the wall in that discussion about whether to open the dome, and there would have been people insisting we have to do it no matter what the weather is, what flashed through my mind, Ed, was the mayor in the movie Jaws. Don't close the beaches!
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
So what went wrong that the taxpayers paid $570 million for the Sky Dome and then sold it to Rogers for $25 million?
Well, I mean, it's a classic terrible business. I think at one point they said in order for the dome to even just cover the cost that they had sunk into it, it would need to operate 24/7, 600 days a year, which we both know is not actually possible. So, you know, I think they were just so desperate to unload it for anything. Mr. Rogers came along and I mean, the worst crime, I think, was the name change. I mean, we all still refer to it as the Sky Dome, even though it's not technically called that anymore.
Yeah, and I guess it didn't happen that night, but I think the most memorable incident was when they decided to zoom in on the hotel and show people that there was a hotel along the edge of the stadium, and there happened to be a couple that weren't enjoying the ball game. They were enjoying one another.
Yeah, that's more elusive footage. Unfortunately, I haven't come across that yet, but that's out there somewhere.
Ed Conroy, columnist for BlogTO and freelance writer. Good to have you. Are you going to the game tonight?
Unfortunately not, but I'll be watching.
Okay, me too. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Jerry. Cheers.
Thanks for listening. Tune in tomorrow between 9 and noon on In-Depth Radio, News Talk 1010.